Good morning. Welcome, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to all of our online viewers for our Sabbath services here at Tomorrow's Church of God. For our first song today, if everyone would please turn to page number 25 and stand, we are going to sing Glorious Things of Thee Are Spoken. Page number 25. Great start. Now, if everyone will turn to the back, we're going to turn all the way to page number 119. And we're going to sing Not Many Wise Men Now Are Called, after which we'll get Mr. Barry Sherritt to come do our opening prayer. Page number 119. Thank you. And now for opening prayer, Mr. Barry Sherritt.
Our great almighty Father in heaven, Father, thank you for this time when we can present ourselves before your throne. And we do thank you for this privilege and opportunity. And we do ask that you will be with us in spirit and mind and power and heart to hear your inspired words. And we do ask that you will inspire our listening, Father, that your message will be confounded upon us, and we do thank you for the protection of this week to bring us here once again. We do give you thanks in your son's great mighty name. We do ask that your will be done.
Thank you, Barry. And for our first message today, Mr. Randy Sherrick.
Good morning. The title of this is Your Cave. Now, the cave is a metaphor, but it actually happened. It's a metaphor of where are we hiding? What we're going to do is turn to 1 Kings 9:19. That is the verse that we are going to be working off of. And this is when Elijah is running from Jezebel. She made a threat, and he took off running. And he has ran, and he's finally run to this cave. And in 1 Kings 19:9, it reads, "And there he went into a cave and spent the night in that place. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him and said to him, 'What are you doing here, Elijah?'" God asked Elijah a point-blank question. What are you doing in this cave? Why was he in the cave? Because of a threat by a queen. He ran. Why did he run? Because he made the queen upset and she threatened his life. So what did Elijah do once when this threat was given to him? It's all in the chapter of chapter 19 in 1 Kings. First thing he did when the threat came, it says he arose and ran for his life. Because of a threat of a queen, he ran. And then he ran to Beersheba, and there he left his assistant and continued running. He ran to a broom tree, and he laid underneath it, and he made a prayer to God, "Oh, please let me die." Now, what in the world kind of a prayer is that? Number one, he's running because of a death threat, and now he's praying to die, all because of why? He was afraid of a threat. And he continued running until he went to this cave, and there God made contact with him. What did he do? He left his ministry. God gave him a job, a task to do. And not only did he leave his ministry, but he left his assistant behind in Beersheba, and he kept running. What God gave him a job to do, he was running from it because of fear. Does the exact same thing happen to us? How do we deal with our problems? Do we deal with them head on, or do we hide in a cave as Elijah was hiding in a cave? Elijah was afraid. But here's the whole thing. When he was afraid, what did God do? God still communicated with him. He's in this cave, and he's running. But God came to that cave and asked him, "Why are you running? What is the point of running?" So here's a question. When we run, when we hide, when we are afraid, why? Is it because we are afraid to deal with our problems head on? We have a problem in our life. Do we run from it because we're afraid to deal with it head on? Or are we afraid of the outcome? The outcome may not be what we want. Therefore, we run and we don't deal with the problem. Or are we afraid that we may lose something because of this problem? So we try to run from the problem so we don't lose it. Okay, Elijah was afraid of a threat of his life being taken from him. What are some of the excuses we use? Elijah used the threat or the excuse of, I am afraid, so he ran. What do we use as excuses? Do we use fear as an excuse? A fear of being bullied? Of looking bad? Of being embarrassed? Is jealousy a reason we run? Because we are comparing ourselves to others, and it's, woe is me, I'm not getting what I should because of comparison, because of jealousy. Is it anger? I'm not getting my own way. So that drives us into a cave because we are angry. Pain and suffering, does that drive us away from God? How about my feelings got hurt? And because my feelings got hurt, I am mad and I am running because my feelings got hurt. What does all of these excuses have in common? They are all emotions. It's an emotional feeling we have, and because of that emotional feeling, we are deciding to leave God, to run, to not do what God says or have given us the task to do. Do we hide in our caves because of jealousy, envy, anger? Here's the thing. When we let our emotions control us, we think that we can fix the problem on our own instead of giving the problem where the problem should be given to. 1 Peter says, casting all your cares upon him, for he cares for you. That's what Peter wrote. If you have a problem, give it to God. Do the best you can, but let God deal with it, because he already knows about it. He probably already has an avenue of escape for you, as long as you allow him to work with you. Instead of trying to do it on your own, give the problem over to God and then do your best or as God leads you. But how do we get out of these caves? When we're in a cave because of anger, fear, jealousy, whatever. When we start to separate ourselves from God, how do we get out of this emotion? First thing you do, remember. Remember what God has done for you. When God rescued you, when your life was in peril, when you might have gotten hurt, and God saved you, an auto accident. You should have been killed in the auto accident, and you weren't. Why? Because God saved you. Remember the blessings that God has given us. And what's the first blessing of all? That God actually called us to be part of his family. Think about this country we live in, the food that we have, the freedoms we have. We're blessed with families, with jobs. We're blessed with God's Holy Spirit. And we are blessed that we can literally talk to God and he will listen to us in prayer. Remember all of the blessings that God has given us and ask ourselves, why are we in this cave? Because God probably already has an answer of how to take care of the problem as long as we give it to him. First thing you want to do is remember. Here's what Elijah should have remembered. He was threatened. He should have remembered, hey, I said that rain was not going to fall for 3 years, and rain did not fall for 3 years. I was fed by ravens through this drought. I was fed by a widow through this drought. She had just enough food, and it was always there every day through the drought. Her son got sick, was on the point of death. I anointed him, and God healed him. All of these blessings. And then a blessing. He had 450 prophets of Baal, 400 prophets of Asherah, that he proved that they were useless, and he called fire from heaven, and his altar was, God put fire up on his altar where those prophets of Baal and Asherah could do nothing. And all he did was call fire down, and the fire came down, and it even licked up all of the water that was on his altar. He was able to call fire down from heaven. All he had to do was remember about the power God has given him, the blessings God has given him. Same thing with us. When we are at that point of running, getting into a cave, remember everything God has done for us. He even outran the king going to a town. The king was in a chariot. He lifted up the skirts around his feet, it says. Spirit came upon him, and he outran that chariot to the town. All he had to do was remember. After all of this that he could have remembered, he ran to a cave, and what did God say? Elijah, why are you here? Why are we in a cave when all we have to do is remember all the blessings God has given us? That's the first point. Second point is listen. Do we actually literally listen for the voice of God? Here's the thing. Elijah's in the cave. God's talking to him. God said, get out of the cave. And then there was an earthquake that tore apart rocks. And it says that the voice of God was not in the earthquake. Then there was a great wind, or I got it backwards maybe. Then there was a great wind. Well, okay, there was a wind first, then an earthquake, and it said there was no voice in it. Then there was fire after that, and it said there is no voice in that. And then it said, and after the earthquake, a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire, and after the fire, a still, small voice. Suddenly a voice came to him and said, what are you doing here, Elijah? Do we listen to the voice of God? And how do we listen to it? By reading the scriptures. What God inspired, what God breathed upon. Do we literally listen for the voice of God when we have a problem? There's no problem God cannot take care of. And then when God was saying, Elijah, why are you here? God is not asking the question for his awareness. God is asking the question for Elijah's awareness. God is asking Elijah, why don't you have faith in me? Every time we run to a cave to hide, is God not asking us the same question? And then the last point, obey God. Do what God says. Obey God and get back to work. And on 1 Kings 19:15, it said, then the Lord said to him, go return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus, and when you arrive, appoint Hezekiah as king of Syria, appoint another king, get your replacement, Elisha. He still had work to do. And Elijah listened to God, got up, and started to do what God said to do. We give too much value for what puts us into a cave. That is an affront to God, that we have left him by going into a cave. Instead of giving our problems to God, we run. That's an affront to God. He wants us to come to him with all of our problems. Ask yourself this. Does God want us in a cave when it comes to Passover? When we're at the Passover service, is there anything that has put us into a cave? Or have we given all of our problems to God so that we, as 1 Corinthians 11:28, But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the eternal's body. Do we have a problem when we come to the Passover, or have we given all of our problems to God and asked him to show us the avenue of escape? It's time for us to leave the caves that has driven us away from God. Stop saying, woe is me, stewing in our own self-pity, our own anger, our own rages. It's time to remember the blessings of God, listen to that small voice of God, and obey God and get back to work. Don't say at Passover, why am I in this cave? Don't have God ask you, why are you in this cave?
Thank you, Randy. For a couple of announcements before next song, I still have a note here. It says Passover starts sunset April 14th. The first day of unleavened bread is April 16th at 11 a.m. It will be here. It starts on the 15th. Randy, you're looking at me with a puzzled look. So it starts on the 15th, but the services will be here the 16th here at 11. Okay. And then also, we're getting close to the time of to get ready for the Feast of Tabernacles 2022. The time frame is going to be October 10th through October 17th. It will be hosted by Tomorrow's Church of God here in Temple, Texas. It won't be here in Temple, Texas. It's actually going to be in New Braunfels at Sun Outdoors, Texas Hill Country. Now, I know that sounds like a new name. It is a new name, but it's exactly the same place. So where we've been before, it's the same place, new name. Again, the name of it is Sun Outdoors, Texas Hill Country in New Braunfels. Let's see, we get a discount. You can go online and take a look at the web at their website at sunoutdoors.com/Texas/Sun Outdoors Texas Hill Country. Hope you got that. I went through it fast. Yeah, didn't get it? It's www.sunoutdoors.com/Texas/Sun Outdoors Texas Hill Country. Yeah. Yeah, just go to Google, type it in. Yeah, thanks, Randy.
It's online.
It's online.
On our website,
their link to their website is on our website. And that website is thetcog.com.
Don't book online, it says.
I'm getting there, Billy, I promise. It says, do not book online. Oh, Charlotte. No, I know Charlotte said it, but Billy's put it up there for me already. It says, do not book online for the 20% discount. And just so you know, the price you see online, we get 20% off. But to get the 20% off, you must call 830-625-1919. And again, I'm sure that's going to be on the website also, on our website. There will be a $250 deposit per cabin. Current cabin RV pricing listed on the church's website is based on prices for April 1st, 2022. There's big red letters here that says prices are not guaranteed and prices are subject to change. As you know, right now, the economy is fluctuating. So the prices may change between now and then. Please book as early as you can to lessen your price change, even if you just pay the refundable deposit of $250, that will lock in your price. Okay. That's the longest announcement I've had to read. Also, we do have a prayer request for Zion Zeke Quick. He is my second cousin. He was born this week. Problem is, he was born 26 weeks early, and he is 1.8 pounds. But he's doing fantastic. Mom and Dad are doing fantastic. They're up in Fort Worth, I believe. He's doing fantastic. Just ask for prayers to continue on the fantastic growth that he's doing. Little bitty baby. Saw a picture yesterday, and he is not this big. All right. If there are any other announcements? Nope. All right. For our next song, If everyone would please turn to page number 71 and stand, we're going to sing, Lord, I Will Praise Thee. So page number 71. Thank you. And now for our main message today, Mr. Ron Harmon.
Greetings. Hi. Welcome to all you out there in internet land. A couple of things I got to clarify before I get into my sermon. The current room rates and stuff for the Feast of Tabernacles is online. They'll be refined down a little bit more, but I hurriedly put them on because I just got all the information yesterday. So then I had a dozen other things to get done too. So I put them on there. They're there. So just kind of make your way through it. All right. Like I said, we're less than 2 weeks away from Passover and 2 weeks away from the first day of unleavened bread, which will be here at 11 a.m., plus the last day of unleavened bread will also be here at 11 a.m. Bring your unleavened bread. Not your leavened bread, your unleavened. Okay. Also, on the calendar, if you happen to get one of our 2022 calendars this last year that you are guiding yourself through this year, there is a slight mistake on one of them. And we are going to cover that on the day after the first day of unleavened bread, which begins at sundown on Friday. We have the Sabbath, which is the next day, which is 2 weeks from today, as I mentioned. And that is the first day of unleavened bread, actually. But the day after that is the wave sheaf offering. Our illustrious calendar maker happened to put the wave sheaf offering on that Sabbath and not on the following Sunday. So you might want to correct that in your calendar. That's the only one we found so far, mistake wise, but we're searching pretty hard now, so okay. I call this sermon Bad Prophecies, because when you look at the news today and you look at everything that's going on out there today, there's just a ton of people out there that's trying to stoke the fires of an apocalyptic fears and all these kind of things, and they're doing this all over the place on TV and on platform, social media platforms and different things like that. Everybody has an opinion, you know. Oh, the Russian, the Great Bear, he's in prophecy or whatever, and all this, and you know, it's really weird, but you always, bad news, really bad news, seems to always cause the prophets to emerge from out of nowhere. You know, all of a sudden, you know, here they are, all the prophets, you know, as soon as war starts. And good times, you know, they're not conducive for prophets. You know, they really wouldn't, you know, they're not good for would-be Elijahs. What's he going to do? Going to run around and say, well, the neighborhood yelling, peace is coming, peace is coming. No, they got to have bad things happening before the prophets can do their trade. So doom and gloom is the backdrops of attracting their following, so to speak. And the Russian invasion of Ukraine is the newest one to the end of the world people. I hear it occasionally and I see it occasionally. I don't know about you, you know, but I do kind of look at those kind of things, and it's out there quite a bit. And I've seen just about every scenario one might imagine how the Bible will be fulfilled within this last few months or this year or whatever, however you want to coach it. Now, I don't deny one single bit that it looks bad out there, and it looks like, you know, we're running out of time. Things are going to happen. I get that. I have those feelings too. But you've got to look at the Bible, and you've got to go through the scriptures to understand how the end times will come about. Now, every one of these would-be prophets believes they know what's going to happen. And that thing driving me nuts. And everyone is 100% certain they have it correctly. And the really bad part about all this is people are going to believe them. And I mean, a lot of people are going to believe them. And they're going to follow right along, despite the warnings of not being carried away by charismatic men or women claiming to come in the name of Jesus. They're still going to go out there, and they are going to give their version of what's happening. Now, the truth is, they could be just folks spouting off about what they perceive as the truth. I get it. You know, I mean, a lot of people do that, right? I spout off sometimes. But and they could come from our church. I've seen some comments from people that believe like we do, you know, about, you know, this is the end time, or this is Russia, or this is this, you know, trying to put the pieces together. But we can't always know and what their intentions are. And they could be just lawless men and women with their own agenda, trying to create a following. We don't know. So we're supposed to be sure, right? And either way, whatever their intentions are, they could be dangerous to our spiritual well-being if we want to follow them, or if we decide to follow them. And the other problem is by this chicken little attitude about everything going wrong and everything happening and the end times coming, you know, within the next year or 3 years or whatever, they create this lethargic atmosphere within those that are skeptical to begin with, and so whenever things do happen, they don't pay attention to it. You yell it too often and folks will just quit listening. Well, scriptures teach in 2 Peter 3:17-18, and don't let the list scare you. It's going to be a lot longer than what it is. No, I'm not.
Really?
No, I'm just teasing. Anyway, 2 Peter 3:17-18 says, "You therefore, beloved, knowing this beforehand, be on your guard so that you are not carried away by the error of unscrupulous people and lose your own firm commitment." He says, don't let the, don't let them carry you. Don't let them convince you other than what the scriptures teach, because you'll be carried away by these unscrupulous people. And he didn't say whether they were in church or out of church, whether they were part of God's group or whether they weren't. He just said unscrupulous people. But he goes on to say in verse 18, he says, "But grow in grace and knowledge of our Lord Savior Jesus Christ. To teach to him be glory both now and to the day of eternity." So when we hear folks giving their ideas of what's happening worldwide, we are to do as the Messiah says to do and test what we hear and compare it to the scriptures, right? And so we have a couple examples that we can go by of folks who have done this in the past and what Christ says that they did. The first one is in Revelation chapter 2, verse 2 through 3. Well, that's easy to say. Anyway, he says, "I know your deeds and your labor and perseverance, and that you cannot tolerate evil people, and you have put those that call themselves apostles to the test." He says, they even tested the apostles. I mean, nobody was going to tell them something that they didn't verify to be true. And that's good. And that's what we're supposed to do. And they are not, and some of them weren't. You know, there's many people walking around out there claim to be apostles. They still claim Herbert W. Armstrong was an apostle. You know, if you go on the internet and you look, and you found them to be false. Well, how did they do that? Well, they tested what they said. They tested what they claimed to be. And that's what we should do. That's what everybody, not just the people in our church, in our group, but every church. You should test what your minister is telling you is the truth. And if it does not match what's in this book, then you're wrong. You know, you have to make a decision. You have to make a decision whether you're going to follow them or not. And he says, "And you have perseverance and have endured on my account of my name and have not become weary." So we can't just give up. We can't just not do it and just say, okay, well, he's the boss. He's going to tell me how to get to heaven. You want me to? No. He says, and then there's this example that he gives us in 1 Thessalonians 5:19-21. He says, "Do not quench the spirit. Do not utterly reject prophecies." And so we're not to reject prophecies. We're not to reject what people say, but we are to verify it. And because in verse 21, he says, "But examine everything, hold firmly that which is good, abstain from every form of evil." So we are to examine it. We are to see whether it's proper, we are to see whether it is pertinent to what that person is, what's going on around us and what that person says is happening. And by testing what he or she says, one can avoid frustration, becoming weary and flooded by false doctrine. So, now, let me say this. There may be one or two out there that get close to the truth occasionally. And that can be as dangerous as somebody just being 180-degree difference in what the scripture says, because you might have a tendency to want to follow them. But you have to go by what the scriptures say, right? But and so we're to figure that out. We're supposed to do that ourselves and not rely upon some sky pilot to do it for us. What, you don't like sky pilots? uh, That's my endearing term for preachers. And you know, the Creator, He's a lot more complex than just laying out things for anybody and everybody to understand. He makes it a challenge for us so that we will keep our nose in the Bible. It's just as simple as that. He's not going to give us the answer. It's not going to be a multiple choice answer. It's, you know, I mean, where you could just, you know, C is a default answer. You know, no, it's not going to be like that. And like they say, even a blind hog can find an acorn every once in a while. So every once in a while, one of them's going to get something right. But don't let them fool you in that respect. So, and consider this. If man could know what God is doing on this earth, don't you think he'd have figured it out by now? Really, I mean, stop and think about it. All the prophets we've had over the years, all the people, all the religious people out there in the world that's had Bibles and everything, don't you think we'd have figured it out by now? I mean, it's been, what, 6,000 years? How long does it take? So, why would somebody off the street, you got to think about these kind of things. Why would somebody off the street that you don't know, just come out of nowhere, all of a sudden have all the answers? Well, he wouldn't, or she wouldn't. But that won't stop them from trying, I can tell you. But they all fail in one aspect. They fail to recognize God doesn't think like men. And he tells us that in Isaiah 55, 8 through 9. Isaiah tells us that. He says, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor my ways your ways, declares the Lord. For heavens are higher than the earth, and so my ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thought." So he's not, we might think what you, I don't think there's ever been a prophecy in the Bible that has been fulfilled the way man has claimed it's going to be fulfilled. I really don't. But let me throw my hat in the ring. Let me tell you about future events. And these are my predictions based upon the Bible, according to the Messiah's words. And I'm not gonna make assumptions. I'm not gonna make calculations or anything like that. I'm gonna show you what the Scriptures say. Okay? So we need to focus solely upon Scripture, not upon assumptions or speculation. First off, I want to address one thing when it comes to Russia in prophecy before I get into the rest of this, because there's been a lot of that on news here lately. There's a Scripture in the book of Daniel that talks about the king of the north and king of the south. Now here lately, all these people are associating the king of the north as being Russia. And the king of the north is speaking of Russia, and Russia playing a major role in the end times. And they say, see, here it comes, here they come. They're rolling in end time. Well, the original king of the north mentioned in Daniel 11 was a series of Greek kings in Syria called the Seleucid dynasty. And the king of the south was at that time the restored kingdom of Israel that's spoken of in Daniel. Now, I know I'm not going to say anything that's going to dispel the notion that Russia is the king of the north, but I'm going to try anyway, so here we go. There have been many conquering nations in the north side of Israel over the past 2,500 years. Too many to count, probably. And so my question is to the people today, why do you settle upon Russia today? Just because they're invading today. Anyway, they ain't looking all that good anyhow. I mean, they don't look like the giant bear depicted in their reliefs. And so I have my doubts. And my belief, and simply my belief, is that the kings of the north and kings of the south, they represent ideologies. And how I describe that is, if you look north of Israel, most of those nations north of Israel are Christian nations. I think there may be one or two, like Turkey or something else, that is Muslim nation, but the majority of them are Christian nation. Now, you can have a different interpretation. That's fine. I don't think anybody will be able to totally figure that out until Christ comes. And everyone is entitled to their own thoughts. But let me say this. I'll add this from the imputing part of my spirit here. If you can't even get the day right that you're supposed to worship on, according to scriptures, you might want to steer clear of trying to figure out the book of Daniel. And I'm not trying to be cute or snide, but it may sound like it, and I'm apologizing if it does. But seriously, if you're trying to avoid the Sabbath commanded by the Bibles, the Bible's own words, and God's holy days, and you're eating unclean foods, and then you try to attempt to explain the prophecies from the Bible, well, I'm pretty sure you're going to be wrong. And I've got absolutely no doubt about it. But back to the king of the north and king of the south mentioned in Daniel. As I said, I believe these are ideologies in the world today, not actual kings. And the one thing that's never changing in any of the scenarios that is put forth in the Bible, what kingdom it is or what nation it is that is in power, it's the threat against God's people that is always constant. And that's something that you got to keep in mind. That's something that is key to prophecy. The chosen people the Creator calls His own, they belong to the Father and the Messiah, and they are key to any estimations or understandings of the end times. If you slough them off, if you push them to the side, I guarantee you you're going to be wrong. And it doesn't matter who's in power at the time, the focus will always be upon them. Now, let's look at what the Messiah says about the end times. First, we need to set the background. And to do that, we're going to examine Matthew 23. And we're going to do this to put Matthew 24 into context. And we're going to briefly do this in Matthew 23 because I don't want to spend a lot of time on this, but I want to set the stage, so to speak. And the conversation begins in Matthew 23, where the Messiah offers up seven distinct woes. And some say eight. Okay. I searched through there, and I couldn't find eight. But I did find seven, okay? And these woes were directed from the Messiah to the ruling class of the people of that day. And it's my understanding or my belief that we need to better understand the Olivet prophecies. We need to go through these right quick. Now, the word woe is an exclamation of grief, or denunciation, or distress. Okay? And like I said, this is a condemnation of the Messiah to the religious leaders of his day. He made a point to expose their hypocrisy. So we begin where he says in Matthew 23:13, and like I said, remember, he's speaking to the Pharisees, Sadducees, and scribes, and all these folks there. It says, they taught about God, but did not love God. They did not enter the kingdom of heaven themselves, nor did they let others enter. Some of them did not believe in the resurrections and so forth. So they were teaching this, and they were denying people the opportunity to become part of God's kingdom. And the second woe he talked about, he says, they created followers who advocate their lies and way of thinking. They preached God, but not converted people, converted people to their dead religion. thus making those converts twice as much as a son of hell as they themselves were. Or son of perdition or whatever, I don't know. The third was that they taught that an oath sworn by the temple or altar was not binding, but if you swore by the gold or ornamentation of the temple or by a sacrificial gift on the altar, it was binding. The gold and the gifts, however, in their estimation, were sacred because they lined their pockets. It made them wealthy. The temple, it did derive a measure of lesser sacredness by being connected to the temple or altar. That's where the offerings came. And the teachers and the Pharisees worshipped at the temple and offered sacrifices at the altar because they knew that the temple and altar were sacred. But they did not teach that. Number four, they were self-imposed teachers of the law, but did not practice the law. And some of them did not practice the most important part of the law, but deferred to the lesser of the laws, like tithing. But they did not defer to justice and mercy and things of those matters of the law. It's kind of like today, you know, money's the most important thing. Teach, you know, forgive your neighbor, okie dokie. Well, if you don't, we'll just make you rub a bunch of beads and say 20 Hail Marys or whatever, you know. You can go on your way. But if you know you're going to hate your neighbor, then you go ahead and buy indulgence, right? They presented appearance, number five, of being clean, self-restrained, not involved in carnal matters, yet they were dirty inside with worldly desires and carnality. In other words, they were full of greed and self-indulgence. They exhibited themselves as righteous on account of being scrupulous, this is number six, and keepers of the law, but defiled the laws of God. They had maintained a mask of righteousness while hiding their inner world of ungodly traditions, and they were full of wickedness and disguised as godly. They were like whitewashed tombs, beautiful on the outside, but full of dead men's bones. They professed a high regard, number seven, for the dead prophets of old, claiming that they would never have persecuted or murdered the prophets, but were doing the same as the ones who were murdering of old. Case in point, i.e. the Messiah. Now, I can't help but compare them to what's happening in the religious world today of Christianity, and where we're getting much of our prophecies from, by the way, and how the Messiah focused on how the religious world were treating the people of his day. And so after all this, he set the grounds, he walks off the temple or out of the temple, and the Messiah is asking him a question. He says, as he was sitting in Matthew 24:3, and it says, as he was sitting on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately saying, tell us when all these things will happen and what will be the signs of your coming at the end of the age. Because he told them prior to that, he says, not one stone's going to be left atop another of this building. Mainly because of what the Pharisees and Sadducees and religious leaders of that day were doing. Much of what they were accused of, they're doing today. So the answer he gives is centered around the very question the world is concerned with today, because they can't get the right answer from the religious community. And this is the last place folks tend to look for answers, is in the Bible. They're too busy waiting on the rapture. So let's see what he said. Matthew 24, verses 4 through 5. And Jesus answered and said to them, see to it that no one misleads you. That's the first thing he says. See to it no one misleads you. That's the first thing he says. For many will come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and they will mislead many people. Now, Christianity uses the name Jesus, and under that auspices, they create their own following and make their own rules and set their own stage for what they believe, or I don't know if they believe it or not, or what they say is truth. They come bearing the name of Jesus as an authority to the God's church. They reject the Sabbath, the holy days, and the only times that God commanded man to worship on, in place of Sunday and the secular holidays. And they also think nothing else in the Old Testament is relevant, especially things like the food laws, except tithing. I wonder why that is. Now, it's my belief the Messiah, was referring to the religious leaders of that day, but also to the ones that were coming at the end times, because he goes straight into the end time. And he predicted that the religious community would be doing this, would be having this kind of characteristics or having this mode of thinking. And they were already doing it. Actually, at that time, they were already coming in his name and doing things. Mark 9, 38 through 41. It says, Mark 9, 38 through 41 says, Teacher, John said, we saw someone driving out demons in your name. And we told him to stop because he was not one of us. And Jesus says, don't stop him. Jesus said, for no one who does a miracle in my name can in the next moment say anything bad about me. For whoever's not against us is for us. And truly I tell you, anyone who gives up a cup of water in my name because you belong to the Messiah will certainly not lose their reward. Now, this guy was driving out demons in the Messiah's name while he yet lived. Now, we can discuss whether that was his name exactly, or they were coming in the Messiah's, as a representative of the Messiah at that time, not specifically Jesus, if you want to use that moniker. And there's a difference between using the name following what the Messiah commands. If you're coming and you're doing what he commands you to do, or changing the things in someone's name and claiming the Messiah wanted those changes, which he never advocated. There's a difference in those two things. Right? Did I make that clear, or was that muddy? But many come in the name, attempting to mislead the religious world of today with their version of what God's word says, and coming as representatives of the Messiah. Now, many come claiming the ownership of God's truth. There are a few denominations out there that do that. But as Matthew 23 says, those are the blind leading the blind. So let's go forward. Matthew 24 and 6. He says, and you will be hearing of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not alarmed, for those things must take place, but that is not yet the end. Well, here we are. Here's the verse speaking of wars. This is the one that gets people all excited. Wars and rumors of wars. Well, what did the Messiah say? Now, I'm using the New American Standard Bible, which is supposed to be one of the closest translations to the actual wording. And he said, these are wars and rumors of war. Well, my question is, are these minor wars or major wars? Is there a difference to those fighting in the wars? War is war, right? Yet every time we see a significant conflict, we assume that it's the end times. Because it's war. It's a big war. But currently, in this world today, there are 40 conflicts around the world happening. But we don't hear about most of those because Russia conflict is overshadowing everything else in the world. And always has been. There's always been about 40 to 50 conflicts constantly happening around the world. One will quit, another one will boil up. So what else did the Messiah say about wars? He said they must take place. They have to happen. Well, why? I know there's all you peaceniks out there going, well, why must we have war? Let me tell you. Anyway, the short answer is they're necessary. What? Yeah, they're necessary. They are a necessary evil. Why? Does a Messiah advocate war? Of course not, but neither does he interfere with the quarrels of men unless he needs to make an example or use it for his own purpose. Does he want innocent people to die? Well, no. Once more, no. It's his desire for man to live in peace, but men don't want to live in peace. So, wars must happen to move the players into place so that end times can eventually occur the way that they are supposed to. It's through war that nations move. It's through war that boundaries are set. It's through war that God's word is pushed forward. But he also says wars aren't the end all for his plan. So by the wording, I don't look to the wars that are happening around the world to tell me when the end is near. Not going to. And like I said, I know wars do important things. And one more very important thing that wars do, and famine also, when those things happen. Even the strongest that are involved in the world, or that are in the world, that are involved in wars, will fall to their knees in front of the Creator during a war. It will bring atheists into the fold, so to speak. It tends to open the hard-shut minds to the existence of God. When you see your world blowing up around you, you're going to pray to your Creator. And you're going to start seeking Him out. And I think that is probably one of the more important elements of war than anything else. In the next verse, he also points out another thing that will take place along with wars. He says in Matthew 24, verse 7 through 8, he says, "For nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and there will be famines and earthquakes in various places. But all these things are merely the beginning of the birth pains." He says these are just the beginning. What he has just said is just the beginning. And indeed, our illustrious president has made a proclamation that there's going to be a worldwide food shortage because of the present conflict that's going on. Well, he might be right about the worldwide food shortage, but it's not because of the wars. But something no one had a clue about 2,000 years ago, it's oil. That's what's driving that. And yes, I'm sure the Messiah knew about oil during his day, but he didn't tell the disciples about it, about today's industry, the oil industry, as far as we know anyway. But here's the thought. Why does the Messiah, in this Olivet prophecy, distinguish kingdom against kingdom compared to wars and rumors of wars? Don't wars evolve from kingdoms going against kingdoms? Why did he feel like he needed to make that distinction? I have a thought, and it's just a thought. Don't go get a rope. But we've seen in scriptures where Satan is said to have a kingdom. Have we not? Well, don't believe me. Look at the wording in your Bible, Matthew 12, 25 through 26, where it says, He, the Messiah, knew what they were thinking and said to them, Every kingdom divided against itself is laid waste, and no city or house divided against itself will stand. If Satan cast out Satan, he is divided against himself. How then will his kingdom stand? Satan has a kingdom, church, ministers, doctrine. He has his own teaching. He has duplicated everything in heaven, as we have talked about many times. It even speaks of his throne in Revelation 2:13. I know where you dwell, where Satan's throne is, and you hold firmly on my name and did not deny my faith even in the days of Antipas, my witness, my faithful one who was killed among you where Satan dwells. So we know the Messiah has all these things because Satan is counterfeiting what is in God's kingdom. He's counterfeiting the Messiah. He's counterfeiting the Father. And it's not the other way around. So we look to the day when we can be with the Savior in his kingdom. So in today's world, we have a battle going on, fully engaged between two kingdoms, between the kingdom of God, or the Father and the Son, and Satan's kingdom. Now, you might think I'm splitting hairs, but I'm trying to make something a little more obvious. And this is part of the reason why people can't understand why all the evil is happening in the world. The battle is occurring between Satan's kingdom and God's kingdom for one reason. It's over God's people. Not this physical world. One might wonder, well, who's winning the battle? And by looking at what's happening in the world today, I can understand why you would ask that question. 2 Timothy 3:7, we can see what they saw happening in their world then and compare it to what is happening to our world today. And this is kind of the battlefronts, the spiritual battlefronts that we are involved in, the spiritual nation against nation. 2 Timothy 3:7, he says, But realize this, in the last days difficult times will come, for people will be lovers of self, lovers of money, boastful, arrogant, slanderers, disobedient to parents, ungrateful, unholy, unloving, irreconceivable, malicious gossips, without self-control, brutal haters of good, treacherous, reckless, conceited lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, holding to a form of godliness although they have denied its power. Avoid such people as these, for among them are those who slip into households and captivate weak women and weighed down with sins, led by various impulses. Always learning, never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. And that's what we do. We look at this physical world, and we try to make spiritual evaluations as to what's happening physically. Well, that's the wrong way to look at it. We have to look at it from a spiritual way, a spiritual ability that is in each one of God's people. And make those determinations. Now, this is a genuine war that we should concern ourselves with. Not the conflicts happening around the world. Yeah, they, like I said, they shape different outcomes. But there's been a war going on between heaven and Satan. And you have to ask yourself, has that war ended? Well, no. It hadn't ended by any degree. As a matter of fact, it's heating up. It says in Revelation 12, 7 through 9. It says, And there was a war in heaven, and Michael and his angels waging war with the dragon, and the dragon and his angels waged war, and they did not prevail, and there was no longer a place found for them in heaven. And the great dragon was thrown down, the serpent of old, who is called devil and Satan, who deceives the world. He is. And what did he begin with whenever he started with his Olivet prophecies? He says, let no one mislead you. But he deceives the world, and he is thrown down to the earth, and his angels were thrown down with him. So the angels that rebelled, they were cast to earth, and they're here among us today. We call them demons. Well, what are they doing? What are they doing? Well, I tell you, they're busy filling the minds of men and women with false scenarios to mislead the masses. Demons are engaged in war of disinformation. They'll get you to believe anything but the truth. Anything but the truth. And that's part of the reason why the world is so unable to discern the truth, why they are so blind and why they are so unable to hear the truth. Because the demonic world is full court pressure to fill their minds with so much disinformation and to have them accept false teachings instead of the truth. And yes, God allows it. He allows it. Well, that's one of his battle tactics. He allows it so that he can have mercy on them at the end time. But let's keep going forward. Once more, we referred back to God's holy people. Well, in Matthew 24, verse 9 through 10, he says this about what's going to happen. He says, then they'll hand you over to the tribulation and kill you, and you will be hated by all the nations because of my name. And at that time, many will fall away, and they will betray one another and hate one another. He's talking about God's people here. He said they're going to hate one another. Boy, and you got to wonder, you know, I know there's a time when we said, oh, that could never happen. But you look out here and you look at all these EIOs running around out here, us included, and they're not willing to open their arms to any other churches. Many of them aren't. And that's part of the reason why I've tried to make it a point over the years to be more accepting of other groups and people in those groups and stuff, because I want people to come together. I don't want to push people away. Now, I know people get mad and things like that, and there's nothing you can do about that. But when the Messiah says they and you in this, he has distinguished between the world and his people. No religion compared the true beliefs of the Bible has been betrayed more than God's people throughout history. None. The Father and Son's people have been the ones persecuted and destroyed in every phase of history. But it also happens by our own hands, as I was saying. And sometimes we do it to ourselves, and we can't make any mistake about that. And I hate to say it, but sometimes God's holy people are some of the most mistrusting people on the planet. And perhaps because of the next verse as well. He says in Matthew 24, 11 through 14, he says, and many false prophets will rise up and mislead many people. And here we are. Every major conflict that happens around the world or major event, people are yelling, apocalypse, apocalypse. Doesn't sound as good as Chicken Little, does it, you know? But they come out of the woodworks. They're like roaches. They just, you know, they come out of the woodwork. All these people making prophecy. And it says in verse 12, and because lawlessness is increased. Because lawlessness is increased. And that's what we see. And most people will, love will become cold. Well, yeah. I mean, when you see the things that are happening to the world today, it's really easy to become cold-hearted. It really is. And I have to correct myself sometimes because I get really angry at some of the things I see. So I have to turn on my soothing, mind-relaxing music and turn the news station off. He says their love will become cold. But the one who endures to the end, one who will be saved, that's the one who will be saved. And you say, well, the end of what? You know, what if he don't make it to the end times? Well, sorry, no. Your end time could be the day you die. That's your end time. So it's the end time spoken of in the Bible, but it's the end of your life. Both are correct in my estimation. But he says many false prophets have arisen, and perhaps that's because of social media. You know, it's increased the false prophet brigade. Because today, communication makes it so much easier for someone to pose as a religious scholar. I see people all the time talking about religion. And talk, and talk, and talk. But ask yourself, are you a false prophet? Really, ask yourself, are you a false prophet? Well, you might want to ask yourself that question before you post the next Facebook post. Because that's how people are going to look at you. And let me ask you this. How many times do you have to be wrong about something to become a false prophet? I was going to say 10 times, 5 times, or just one. Randy beat me to it. Be quiet, Randy. No. Just once. That's it. You're a false prophet. Abraham Lincoln made this quote one time. He says, it's better to remain silent and be thought a fool than to speak and remove all doubt. I like that line. But some folks just can't help themselves, right? I mean, it's a trap they'll fall into every time. Well, the Bible goes on to say, love has grown cold at this time, and lawlessness is extant upon the earth. You can say, well, we're there. We've arrived. Punch my ticket, you know. But consider that there's always been great lawlessness around the world. There always has been. The amount of it or whatever may vary from here to there, time to time. But it's always been around the world. So the next obvious question is, because man's law is determined by countries and time, what is the definition of being without law? It's lawlessness. If you have lawlessness, you have no law. Well, what law are we talking about in the Bible? We're talking about God's law. We're not talking about man's law. And people seem to confuse that. And, you know, and you stop and think about that, because man's law is determined by countries and time. What do I mean by that? At any given time or place, the laws can be different depending on where you're at. That's why you have to know the laws of each country that you travel to, because you can do one thing lawfully in one country, step over a line, and it'll be illegal in the next country. But there is a set of laws that never change, never change. Those are the laws of God. In fact, Paul spoke about lawlessness in his letter to Thessalonians, 2 Thessalonians 2. We'll read verses 3 through 12. And get this, he says, his very first words, no one is to deceive you in any way. They keep telling you this. Don't be deceived. Quit believing these people. For it will not come unless the apostasy comes first, and man of lawlessness is revealed, the son of destruction. Well, if the law is out of the way, how do you have a man of lawlessness? Well, that's my question, but maybe somebody can answer that for me. Who opposes and exalts himself above every so-called god or object of worship, so that he takes his seat in the temple of God, displaying himself as being God. Do you not remember that while I was still with you, I was telling you these things, and you know what restrains him now, so that he will be revealed in his time. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains will do so until he is removed. Verse 8, then that lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will eliminate with the breath of his mouth and bring to an end by the appearance of his coming. And that is the one who is coming is in accord with the activity of Satan, with all the power and false signs and wonder, and with all the deception of wickedness for those who perish because they did not accept the love of truth so as to be saved. Verse 11, for this reason God will send them upon them a deluding influence so that they will believe what is false. See, there you go. Demons are out there just spreading all this. You know, they're encouraging this false information, everything else. And it's a delusion. So to get you to believe something other than the truth. In verse 12, in order that they may be judged who did not believe the truth, but took pleasure in wickedness. So all these people out there says, well, I don't believe God will punish me for this or that because, you know, it's just natural. You know, if it feels good, do it and all this kind of thing. Well, you're deluding yourself. But God says, he changes not, Malachi 3, verse 6. For I, the Lord, do not change, therefore you sons of Jacob have not come to an end. So, man has got to go through all this before the end will come. He tells us that, simply. Including the gospel of the kingdom being preached to the entire world, Matthew 24, 14. This is the gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in the world as a testimony to all the nations, then the end will come. Well, the gospel being preached to the world can be said to have occurred because we have the internet, and this sermon today, right now, is going around the world. Yet, even though it gets transmitted around the world, but because of dictators and tyrants, many aren't allowed to hear it. But what if there is a day, somewhere in the future, when all are allowed to hear God's truth? All at one time. By some religious leader given over the internet, where simultaneously it goes around the world. And every person in every nation has the ability to listen. We have the technology. We just have to get the obstacles out of the way. And the religious leader that stands up there and speaks, he brings peace to the world. Oh, we're breaking out in peace now. And all hear that message from the Bible. Well, look at the next verse, Matthew 24, 15 through 20. He says, when you see the abomination of desolation, which is spoken of through the prophet Daniel, standing in the holy place, let the reader understand. Then those who are in Judea must flee to the mountains, and whoever's on the housetop must go down and get the things out of his house, and whoever is in the field must not turn back to get his cloak. But woe to those women. There's that eighth woe. But woe to those women who are pregnant and to those who are nursing babies in those days. Moreover, pray when you flee, it will not be in the winter or on the Sabbath. So the abomination spoken by Daniel originally was a statue of Zeus erected in the temple of God and a pig offered on the altar of God, replacing the twice daily sacrifice in the temple. Now, that happened around 167 B.C. by the Greek king Antiochus IV. And Antiochus, he went even further. He went by slaughtering great numbers of Jews and selling others into slavery. He issued decrees forbidding circumcision and requiring Jews to sacrifice to pagan gods and also to eat meat. He also forbade the Sabbath observance or the holy days. He despised everything Jewish in appearance, and he attempted to Hellenize the whole region of Israel. And that just makes me think of the world today. When you start bringing out the holy days of things, it says, well, that's old Jewish stuff. Are we still being Hellenized? Well, I say, yeah. But he was eventually overthrown by the Maccabee Rebellion, and eventually the Roman Empire took over. But it never totally went away. Never. Now, after all this happened, the Messiah is ready to say a time, talk about the tribulation and how it affects God's holy people. And you can certainly say that the Jews of that time during Antiochus or 167 BC were going through a tribulation. But in Matthew 24:21, he says this, for then there will be a great tribulation, such as not occurred since the beginning of the world until now, nor even will again. And if those days had not been short, no life would have been saved, but for the sake of the elect, those days would have been cut short. Well, what will mark the time of the tribulation? What does the Bible say? Well, let's look at one other verse. Maybe we can get a clue. Revelation 13, verses 11 through 24. And he says, then I saw, Revelation 13, 11 through 24, then I saw another beast coming out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb, and he spoke as a dragon. He exercises all the authority of the first beast in his presence, and he makes the earth and those who live on it worship the first beast whose fatal wound was healed. Now he performs great signs so that he even makes fire come down out of the sky to the earth in the presence of people. And he deceives those who live on the earth because the signs which it was given to him to perform in the presence of the beast, telling those who live on earth to make an image to the beast who had the wound of the sword and has come to life. And it was given to him to breathe to the image of the beast, so that the image of the beast would even speak and cause all those who worship the image of the beast to be killed. And it caused all the small and great, the rich and poor, and the free and slave to be given a mark on their right hands and their forehead. And he decrees that no one will be able to buy and sell except for the one who has a mark, either the name of the beast or the number of his name. Here is the wisdom. Let him who understands calculate the number of the beast. And it goes on, it says, talks about the number 666. So Satan would be successful if time had not been cut short during this time. And the beast requires, as we saw in there, he requires public worship, a display of loyalty. And it sounds to me a whole lot like Antiochus when he set up the image of Zeus in the temple of God. Because all the elements are there. All the parts of the recipe are there. In same example. He'll forbid buying and selling. Well, you can't do that on the Sabbath. You can only do that six other days a week if you're Jewish, or if you believe like the Jews, or if you believe God. So to me, that's an indication that Sabbaths will be outlawed. Now, you can think what you think. But I also believe that Sunday worship will become a national day of worship at that time. So you have to ask yourself, well, what else will the beast outlaw? Well, here's something curious. In Matthew 24, verse 23 through 26, he says, if anyone comes to you or says to you, behold, here is Christ, or he is over there, do not believe him, for false Christs and false prophets will arise and will provide great signs
Didn't we just see that in Revelation 13? Great signs and wonders, so as to mislead, if possible, even the elect. So you pre-tribulation rapture people out there, you ought to take note of what these scriptures have just said. And goes on saying, verse 25, it says, "Behold, I have told you in advance." So if they say to you, "Behold, he's in the wilderness," don't go out. Or, "Behold, he's in the inner rooms," do not believe them. So what is this saying? Verify. Test. Examine what these people are telling you. Because the world is full of people that are, and demons that are trying to mislead you. This thing, this whole world, you might not see it. You might think I'm nuts. I don't care. The world is out there, and it is trying to turn you against God if you're one of God's people. In any way it possibly can. It's trying to blind you to the truth and to keep you away from the knowledge of God. You might call me a conspiracy theorist. No. But there is some conspiracies that do come true. Now, this occurs after or during the Great Tribulation. So why would he say that if the first resurrection had already occurred? It had. And if Satan has ultimately succeeded, why would those alive need to be aware of false prophets? They're already deceived. But after the tribulation is when the Messiah returns. Not guessing, I'm going by what the scripture says. Matthew 24, verse 29 through 31. But immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will fall from the sky, and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. And then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in the sky. Then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds and of the sky and the power of the great glory. And he will send forth his angels with a great trumpet blast, and they will gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of the sky to the other. And they're all mourning because they go, well, that rapture happened. We're still here. That's right. That's right. Now, hopefully I've done fairly good job of showing you the words of the Messiah and how to determine when the end times will come. I'm not a prophet. I'm just a reader. But don't listen to those on social media or TV or radio or any of the other media that are telling you that it's the end time. Because they're not going from Scripture. They can't be. They're using the same old script from the same old playbook, using their own twist. Don't become one of those blind following the blind. So if you're feeling somewhat confused or lost because of old traditions or false information, don't worry. You have a remedy for it. Read the Bible. I also say this, one last thing. Watch the Vatican. If you can do anything, you want to determine end times, watch the Vatican. Watch what they do and say. Next to God's people, they are one of the key players in all of this. But first and foremost, be ready for his coming. Matthew 24, 42. Therefore, be on alert, for you do not know which day or your Lord is coming. I know that's a little confusing, because we know that certain things have to happen first. So don't be confused. Because if you aren't prepared, nothing else matters. And you have to start preparing long before that day comes. It's not going to be one of those instant deathbed confessions that get you there. You And at the end time, you'll simply be dazed when all this begins, and you'll be mourning like the rest of them. Because you were following false teachings along with all the rest. But it's my duty, and I will try very hard to alert everyone when that day comes, if I can, if they let me on the internet, and be a watchman according to Ezekiel 33. But that might not be enough. So you need to prepare yourself. Remember, you're tasked to work out your own salvation. And like I said, there's not going to be any cliff notes or shortcuts. You can't wait for the last minute and hope to understand. Plug your ears to the media, open your eyes to the scripture.
Thank you, Ron. All right, for our final song today, if everyone would please turn to page number 134 and stand, we're going to sing "To God Be the Glory." Just FYI, there's a second page to this. So, page number 134. Thank you, and I forgot to announce him, but if Billy Stephan could come up here and do our closing prayer today, that'll be all. So sorry to make you run up here, Billy, but thank you.
If that's your running.
No problem. Dear Heavenly Father, our loving Dad, thank you for this great message that you gave us today. Thank you for the food that you provided to nourish our physical bodies. We ask for dismissal from the Sabbath service, and we ask for your protection and guidance throughout the rest of this week, especially on the way home today. Thank you for everything that you've given us, and we ask this through your Son, so let your will be done.